Hi, I'm Mikkel, and this is my video about making a wooden Optimist pram or Optimist dinghy, such as the one you see on the screen right now. This is the Optimist dinghy that I've been making for the last 3 months and which I've just finished. So I'm a boatbuilding student based in Copenhagen, Denmark, and I've been at this boatbuilding school since January, which is for about 6 months now. So, and this was the first boat that I built. And I've taken a lot of photos along the way. And I'll run you through all those photos, so in case you'd ever want to build an Optimist pram, this might be useful for you. So here's the workshop that we've been working out of. I did the project with two friends, two colleagues. We had 3 weeks, which wasn't really enough, but we did the basic things, and after that I finished it mainly by myself. So I'd found some old Optimist masts, which we started out by finishing. So had four masts. One of them became the mast for the Optimist after peeling off all the old varnish and stuff. The other one became the boom, and the third one became the sprit. The fourth one was used for small parts. So this is making a straight line in order to be able to plane it down. We wanted it to be a little bit thinner for the boom and for the sprit. So to make a straight line in order to make this round peg, first an octagon, that's what it's called, an octagon, and then make it, you know, with 16 edges, and then finally round it off. So that's how we made it thinner than it was to begin with. So, but in order to make this octagon, we need to have the straight lines. They are made by pulling the string along the way. And these are the drawings that we used. We found them online. I'll add a link to that under the video. So those are the original drawings made by Clark Mills back in 1948. And just a brief note about the Optimist pram is that his idea was that everybody should get the chance to sail. It shouldn't be expensive. The idea of the Optimist pram was to make a soapbox car for the sea, so to say. And everybody should be able to build it with the readily available materials that you can buy in any hardware store, and you should be able to build it in your garage using normal hand tools. And I would say that it's possible, but it takes a while and it's not that easy. So these are the drawings. Oops. And this is what the finished book. What the finished boat will look like. And actually I think the drawings are pretty good and the explanations are pretty good, but you still need to do quite a bit of thinking yourself. We actually followed the original drawings quite closely, although modern Optimist dinghies are a little bit different, especially with regards to the rigging. So what you see here, the main sheet, is done differently today. So, but we wanted to do it the original way. The rudder also looks quite different in modern boats. So because we didn't have the plywood and the other wood materials that we needed, we started out by doing some small stuff. These are some clamps for the mast we did in oak. This is the paddle, which was glued together. So there's a middle section, and then there are two sections on the side. It was cut out with a bandsaw in a rough shape, and then it was planed using a spoke shave and normal plane to get the final shape. Of course, it was sanded eventually to get a very smooth surface. So this is planing down the mast. I don't remember if it's for the rudder, if it's for the boom, or if it's for the sprit. Might be for the boom actually. lot of nice shavings. During the weekend, I started out making the name sign, Kirsten. That's my daughter, who's 4 years old now. Not quite old enough to sail it herself, but it won't be long, I think. Maybe 2 or 3 years, then she'll probably be able to sail it herself. So, starting out by making this this name sign, had a small piece of mahogany. Nice little project. The design for it is based on traditional Danish sailboats. So it's not really a dinghy sign, but I liked it anyway. And of course the name had to be painted golden. Okay, so this is starting out with the actual Optimist dinghy. So you build it upside down. You make this building template, and then you build the dinghy upside down on this template. Very simple construction, but of course it needs to be extremely precise, because if this is not precise, then your boat won't be precise. So you need to check the dimensions. You need to cross measure, so measure from one corner to the other and see if it's the same distance as the distance from the other corner to, you know, so that the cross is the same distance. If it's not, then you don't have straight corners, and then you'll get into all sorts of trouble. So you need to make this very straight. You know, it's just screwed together, but you need to make it extremely straight in order to get a straight boat and to stay out of trouble for the rest of the project. The next thing we did was to lay out the plywood. So you need one sheet of 18 millimeter plywood, which is how much is that in inches? I don't quite remember. Around a little less than an inch, like 2/3 of an inch. And then you need two sheets of 6 millimeter plywood, which is around, how much is that? 1/3 of an inch or so. And that's actually what you need in terms of plywood. We use some quite cheap plywood because that's what we had the budget for. It's called Östenfinne or Eastern plywood, which is not the best of quality, but it's fine for this type of project. Of course, it needs to be waterproof or water boil proof, which means that the glue used in the plywood is doesn't dissolve in water. So this is Mikaela, one of my friends working on the boat. She's drawing out all the parts that we need to make from the plywood in full size, so we can lay them out on the three sheets to see where we should cut them from. Back to the boom. So we have a square here. And then I've glued two pieces on the side. This is the boom jaw. So the rough shape of the boom jaw will be being glued together. Boom glued and screwed, actually. And then there's a plug put into the hole in order to conceal the screw. So this is Eric making the spread. Again from one of these old masts, which is thinning down now, first making it square, then making it octagonal, and then 16 edges and so on until it's round. This is the boom being glued up. And here are the 18 millimeter plywood pieces. There's the dagger board. There's the stern, there's the rudder, there's the middle, what do you call it, the middle section of the boat, the bow. This is the boom again, being shaved down with a spoke shave from a square to an octagon, made a little jig, which you can see at the end of it. in order to get the right angle. And here it is, rounded nicely and sanded down. Almost done. And you can see Eric there, he's using this plastic thing to get the right curve for the, I think it's for the, either for the stern or for the bow, because it's sort of rounded. In order to get a nice even curve, you can use one of these plastic sticks, and then you just hold them at each end of the curve, and it'll, and you can make a pencil line along the curve. So this is the bow. It's made of pine and some of these this 18 millimeter plywood, glued and screwed together. According to the drawing, we used a polyurethane glue, which is good. It has some disadvantages also. It's foaming, which is good in the sense that, you know, it can fill out small gaps, but it's bad in the sense that it pushes the pieces to get away from each other. So you need to tighten it up very, very closely. You need to screw it very tightly. Otherwise, the pieces will actually separate, and the glue bond will not be very strong. So I would actually recommend using epoxy glue instead, but we were not allowed to use it in our workshop because of security regulations. So we used the polyurethane glue instead, which is good also. It's a little bit easier to work with because you don't have to mix the two components. But then again, it's a little bit harder when you need to scrape off all the excess foam, which was actually turned out to be a lot of work. So I would definitely recommend using epoxy instead. West System epoxy, for example, is very good. Just remember to use gloves, because otherwise you can get a very bad allergic reaction to the epoxy. Aside from that, it's not actually toxic, so you don't need to use any. You don't need to use anything to protect your breathing. So that was the bow. And here it is mounted onto the building template. As you can see, it's kind of at an angle, and it's only the bow that needs to be at this angle. The other two sections just need to stand straight up, so to say. So this is the sign again, the name sign. We're back in the weekends. So the name sign has been cut out, and it's been painted gold and green. And these are some nails, some bronze nails I found on eBay. So again, that was the original drawing saying that you should use threaded bronze nails. So I thought, of course we'll use threaded bronze nails. And they're very nice, and I really like the vintage look of them, and they're beautiful. But they were actually a little bit hard to work with because of this polyurethane glue, but I'll get back to that. Here are the nails. I think they're very old. Alright, so here we have the middle section mounted also. And you can see we've placed a square, just to check that it's perfectly square. So in this, you know, doing this work, it's really important to be as precise as you possibly can. Because if you're not as precise as you can, then you'll run into all sorts of trouble later on with things not fitting right. And you need to spend a lot of time correcting that. So try to be as precise as you possibly can in this phase of the work. See the name sign again. These are blocks. I wanted to make our own blocks also. We need three blocks for the boat. These are made out of oak and glued together with the polyurethane and doweled together. We actually ended up not using the blocks. for various reasons, which I'll get back to. But they're good fun to make, anyway. The piece of dark wood you can see underneath is called asobe. It's an extremely hard type of wood, which we used for the wheels inside the block. So, this is a picture showing one of the hard parts of building the boat. So you make these strips that you need to fit along the sides between the from the stern to the middle section to the bow. And these strips need to be twisted quite a bit. So they need to be bent, but they also need to be twisted in order to fit. And that was actually, I think, the single hardest part of building this boat. In order to make it a little bit easier for us, we soaked the wood. We made a sort of a long box, which we put plastic bags in, and then we soaked the strips for around a day's time or two in order to make them a little bit more supple. And that actually worked really, really well. I would say if you don't do that, you probably won't be able to bend the wood as much as you should. A tricky part was here at the end. You need to find the correct angle. You need to cut it off at the exactly correct angle, and you need to make a notch, which also is has a really, really weird shape. So most people think that an optimist is, you know, is just a square, but it actually has a lot of edges. Like almost everything in this boat is not square. So there are really a lot of fitting to do here. Need to try to hold it up against against the wood, and then cut off a little bit, try it again, cut off a little bit more, fitting, and it takes a lot of time, but it needs to fit well in order to get a strong boat. So, and soaking, of course, is important. So here's a dummy block, looks quite nice. More blocks, more wheels. Drawing of block. Yeah, and here you see the first of the strips along the bottom of the boat. The bottom ones are the hardest because they need to twist more. I would say it's at the top here because we built the boat upside down, but they're at the bottom of the boat. So they're the hardest ones to make because they take a lot of twist, a lot of bending. The top ones don't need to bend as much, so they're not quite as hard. Here we have two of them in place. So it's starting to look a little bit like a boat. And you can see here at the top of the boat, we have two strips that are clamped up. They were wet, and then now we've just clamped them up in order to give them the right shape. So they're drying up now, and they're taking the shape of the boat. They're not glued or screwed or anything yet. This is me cutting out a notch for one of these strips. And this is the mast, which had some old screw holes that we just filled out with a little bit of wood glue and some little sticks that we need. So this is Mikaela with the spokeshave, flattening out the bottom of the boat. So these are the strips that run along the bottom of the boat, and they need to be made, what do you say, flat, so they fit with the rest of the bottom of the boat. So they'll line up with the piece of plywood that'll go on the bottom of the boat. So here we have it with all the strips along the sides. They're screwed and glued with the polyurethane. And this is the rudder. From the drawings, I tried to make it as precise as I could, a full-size drawing of the rudder. It's probably not very, very exact, but it'll work fine, I think. So this again is an example of everything not being straight, even though it's a boat that looks very square. This is the front bottom corner of the boat. So you can see the bow, the plywood, and you can see the strips, and you can see here you can see the construction of the bow, the pine that supports the plywood sheet. So as you can see, all angles are not straight. So it's that's why it takes a lot of time, and why it's, you know, it's not that easy, but it's, of course, it's a lot of fun building boats. I would say that's the difference between boat building and carpentry, for example, that everything here is out of angle, but it's beautiful, I think. Again, a nice curve. So, and this is the rudder being laid out. And here Mikaela and Eric are fitting the plywood for the sides. Trying it on. And then we're just planing everything down in order to make sure that it fits tightly. This is one happy man with some polyurethane glue, not realizing how much scraping off we'd need to do later on. And there was another project at school, Edgar, who's making a Greenlandic kayak using only wood and string, no metal at all. So everything is just tied up and made out of wood and dowels and string. Pretty amazing. So this is what happens when you work with plywood, especially when you work with cheap plywood. This is a limber hole at the bottom of the boat, and we are fitting some strips along the bottom of the boat, and this just happened. It looks really, really bad, but fortunately it can be fixed really easily by just stuffing in a little bit of glue and then putting a clamp on it. So, the hedgehog. As I told you earlier, we used bronze nails for the boat, according to the drawing. So these sides had to be nailed on using bronze nails, and we decided to do that. Although screws probably would have been easier, we thought that's the original way of doing it: bronze nails. But along the way we realized that this polyurethane glue that we use expands, and using these nails probably is not enough for holding everything in place. The glue will probably just push it apart, and that will be very bad. So we found all the clamps we could find, so we nailed it in and then clamped it on, and it was really, really stressful. I would say it's the most stressful part of building this boat. I was putting on those sides, because we had to work so fast. Put it on, hold it in place, driving the nails, putting on the clamps. And putting on the clamps could actually be really hard, because you have these surfaces that are not perfectly straight. So sometimes they just slid off. So it was pretty stressful. I would say if I were to do it again, I would probably use screws instead, because then you wouldn't have to use all those clamps. Just screw it in place, put on the glue, screw it in place, and then you'd be good. Another option would be using no screws at all, and then just no screws and no nails at all, and just gluing it in place, because that would probably also be strong enough. Yes, but it worked okay, but it was a lot of work, and I would say that most people probably don't have this many clamps in their garage. If you want to clamp it nicely and you don't have as many clamps, you could also make some long strips that you clamp along, because then it will distribute the pressure along the clamping area. I would say doing this part of the process, it's really good to be at least three people. Two might be enough, one is definitely not enough. Three people is good, four people is even better, because you really need to hurry. The glue will dry up. And it's kind of hard to handle everything at one time. If I were to do this again, and if I were allowed to use epoxy, I would definitely use epoxy instead of polyurethane. because it doesn't foam up, and it's stronger also. Here you have it again. Looks quite crazy, right? I think it's, yeah, it looks good, but it looks crazy, and it's probably not the best way of doing this. So here you have the little little plywood damage I showed you earlier, glued up quite nicely. Of course, it looks a little bit patchy, but once it's sanded down and varnished, you won't really be able to see it anymore. So, this is the rudder, which has been jigsawed out to its rough shape. And the dagger board Mikaela is making now. It's been jigsawed out also, and now she's planing it to shape. It needs to be sort of sharpened a little bit at the front and the back edges. And Eric driving in nails. This section is the, I think it's called the mast step. So this is where you put, we haven't drilled the hole yet, but this is where you put the mast through, and then it sort of stands on the bottom of the boat. And this is some sort of support, piece of support wood. By the way, if you hear some strange noises in the background, it's my 2 weeks old daughter trying to fall asleep. So, and this piece of wood also, it looks very unsuspicious, but it actually, again, it takes a lot of time to make it because all the sides are not straight. So you really need to, you know, to make it fit. This is the polyurethane foam thing I've been talking a lot about. So even if you try to keep it at a minimum, you know, you get a lot of this and it takes a long time to remove afterwards. So, planing down the bottom, so the sides actually at the bottom. So here you see the bronze nails, look good, right? And so you cut the 6mm plywood out in slightly too big, and then you glue it on. Then afterwards you just you plane it down to the exact correct size. This plane, by the way, is from 1936. It's like, well, 80 years old, still works perfectly. Found it on eBay for, I think, how much was that? £20 in Great Britain, so good tools. And this is the rudder, which has been planed down. You see the different layers of the plywood. And again, this is not the best quality plywood, so it's a little bit hard to plane down, but I guess it worked fine. Here are some other co-students, colleagues, that are making an Indian outrigger canoe. It's in three sections, and it has a pontoon, I think it's called, and a big sail, and it's actually a pretty huge boat. So here are the strips along the bottom of the boat, strengthening a thin strip, and then there's this strip called the keel, and another strip, and we have the daggerboard well attached here, which is where you put the daggerboard through. There's a little trick as to how to make the daggerboard fit the bottom of the boat. Of course, you need to make it fit very well, otherwise your boat won't be watertight, because there'll be a hole along here for where the daggerboard can go through. So what you actually do is you take the daggerboard and you hold it up against this keel plank, which is slightly rounded, and then you draw a line along the edge of the keel board, which will, you draw that on the actual dagger board, which will give you the correct curve. Yes, and here it is mounted with screws and glued on, and then we drilled a few holes, and then just sawed and mortised out using chisels for the correct shape. We used only bronze screws again because we wanted it to be very authentic and very original, but here it really doesn't matter. course, bronze screws are good because they don't corrode, but they're not quite as strong as stainless steel screws. So the most sensible choice would probably be stainless steel screws. And of course, you need to use A4 stainless, not A2 stainless, because that's the only thing that works with seawater. Unless, of course, you only intend to use it in fresh water. Alright, this is Mikaela jigsawing out the bottom piece of plywood. See you in the background there again, and the egg planing in order to make the bottom of the boat fit. The strip you can see, which is lying over the bottom of the boat, we used to determine whether the boat was perfectly flat, you know, whether the bottom would actually touch all points of these strips along the way and touch the edges at the same time. We wanted to be as flat as possible, and we tried to plane it down to make it fit. And here they are fitting the bottom, and you might be able to see some lines here. We actually flipped the bottom of the boat, or the bottom piece of plywood, we flipped it upside down, and then we drew along all the strips, and then we turned it around again in order to see where we could put the screws once the bottom should be attached. So of course, in order to be able to do that, you need to have a perfectly symmetrical boat, but we were quite confident that our boat was symmetrical enough for that. Here we are outside, gluing the bottom onto the boat. We went outside because environmental regulations, because even though it might not be as toxic as epoxy can be, we're still not allowed to glue inside, indoors. So there are isocyanates in polyurethane glue, so we need to be a place where there is good ventilation. So we went outside, carried everything outside, and glued and screwed the bottom onto the boat. Didn't use the bronze screws this time. Or the bronze nails this time. We used screws instead. Oops. Well, this is not quite chronological. Here we are. And aside from the screws, we also put these strips across to get some pressure all along the strips inside the boat, to make them fit nicely. Again, because we use the polyurethane glue, it expands and pushes, so you really need to have good clamping pressure in order to not having it pushing itself apart. And this setup worked just fine. So here we are cutting out the hole for the daggerboard. Again, the lines we'd drawn along the bottom were good for this, because then we knew exactly where we could drill and where we could saw. And the egg, as you can see, is planing off the excess wood, the excess plywood from the sides. Here we are, starting to look a lot like a boat. And as you might be able to see, we've sawn the boat off the building template, and now you can actually turn it around, and it's being lifted off, and it's being turned around, and it's being dropped, which was not good because there was a big hole in the bottom of the boat. So it looked really, really bad, and Mikaela and Eric they were so sorry about this. Fortunately, we were able to fix it, so it didn't turn out a problem at all. So this is the mast step, drilling a hole and drilling through a piece of scrap plywood in order to get a nice hole without any, what do you call, chipping off or anything. And as you can see, the mast will go through here, and then it'll settle on the bottom here. So There's no other wires or anything holding the mast on an Optimist Prime. It just stands there. It works fine because it's such a small boat. And there's a little piece of plywood being attached here. Sort of. I don't know if it's just cosmetical or if it does strengthen the boat a little bit. Anyway, it's in the drawings, and it looks quite good. So we put it on. Again, it takes quite a while to make everything fit just right. So, but it's good fun. Here we have Mikaela fixing the hole. Luckily, it was quite a clean break. So here we've mixed some epoxy, put it on, and yeah, there you see it. Looks pretty bad, right? And clamp, and of course we put some plastic between this block of wood and the epoxy, because otherwise we wouldn't be able to get this off. But actually, just plain plastic, like a plastic bag or anything, works really great because it won't stick to the epoxy. It will leave a nice surface. Yes. So actually, the boat is more or less done here. But in order to get a nice finish, we wanted to make some sort of railing or some rub rail to make it look a little bit better. Make it look a little bit more finished. It's not in the original drawings, but we decided to do that anyway. So we have the quarter knees here, which are in the drawings, but the middle section here and the rub rails along the edges are not in the drawings. Here they've been attached with screws and with plugs. First, there was a strip here, in the inside strip, and then we made the outside strip afterwards. You see a long way. Oh, and this was our exam project, which came in the middle of everything. Tool chest. So that sort of put the project on hold for a month or so, because we had to make this tool chest. Fun project too, but not as challenging as building a boat, of course. All right, so here we're in the chemistry room. This is the epoxy room, because I wanted to strengthen the bottom of the boat a little bit by adding a layer of fiberglass and epoxy. Here you see it, thin layer of fiberglass soaked with epoxy to give it a little bit of extra strength. So this is the rub rail, which has been planed down now, starting to look a lot better. And the rudder and the dagger board, which has been epoxied here. So it's sort of a thin epoxy filler, because the wood structure is so open here, it wouldn't hold up very well. So we gave it a little bit of epoxy just to strengthen it. So now the project time is done, and we are bringing home our project Edgar with his Greenlandic kayak, and the Optimist inside the trailer. So, and then I invited some friends home in our courtyard, so they could help doing the last bit of work. This is Christo and Jonas making the rub rail for, I think that's the stern of the boat. Needs to have the right curve. Bjorn making a block. Still thought I would use the blocks at that point, but ended up buying some instead. Yeah, about these blocks, I wanted to make it very traditional, but I got a sail from a sailmaking student who had made an Optimist sail as an exam project. It's a very modern sail. Beautifully made. And I thought, using very extremely big, bulky, old-fashioned blocks with a very modern sail would look ridiculous. So I decided on making the rig pretty modern, using modern ropes and modern blocks, modern sail, and then the rest of the boat would be traditional. So that was why I decided on not using the wooden blocks anyway. So this is our courtyard, very nice place. Everybody working? The kids playing? Nørrebro in Copenhagen, by the way, if you ever want to drop by. Filing out the block. We'll probably find a use for the blocks at some other point. Here we have Asker. He's removing excess glue from inside the boat. Lunchtime. This is Nikki filing on the sprit. That's this little peg at the end of the sprit, which goes into a loop on the sail. Needed to be a little bit smaller. My sister filing on the block. So here we have it, with everything in place and the entire rub rail sanded down nicely. Quarter knees. So it's almost ready for varnish actually. Decided to varnish everything except the bottom of the boat, which should then be white. And the rudder and the dagger board should also be painted white because I didn't want this plywood finish to be visible. So now it's being transported into a summer house, sort of kolonihave it's called. It's like a garden house, which would be a temporary paint booth then. Here we have it, kolonihave, the garden house, everything lined up, varnish and paint. We use some two-component International Perfection Plus polyurethane varnish, which is supposed to be the strongest varnish you can get. Should last about 3 or 4 times longer than regular old-fashioned one-component varnish. It's extremely toxic, so you really need to use one of these masks with a good filter if you use this type of varnish or paint. Alright, so here it is, ready for varnishing. The paddle, the rudder, the tiller. I think this is the sprit. Everything lined up. First layer of varnish, I think, or maybe second. It's really changed color. The eastern plywood has become a lot darker. So it really gets this dark chocolate, white chocolate look now. Yes, and I still thought I would use the the wooden blocks at that point, so this is some bespoke shaving work, but yeah, finished block, looks quite nice. And these are the wheels for the blocks, clamped up and filed, you know, filing this little groove for the rope. Alright, so the boat got 5 layers of polyurethane varnish, and now it's being painted under the bottom 3 times. Just a quick note on this, put some tape here, and before applying the white paint, I gave it a layer of varnish on top of the tape in order to fill any gap or crack that might be at the edge of the tape. Let it dry out, and then I gave it the white varnish, because otherwise the white paint might creep underneath the tape, which would look really bad. So, but 3 layers of white paint. This is the little, what do you call it, wind pennant for the top of the mast. Oh, I guess the photos here are not quite chronological, because this is the tiller, which we also saw in a finished state on the previous photo. So this is the rough blank for the tiller. I found a piece of mahogany. I thought the tiller should be made of some very nice wood. So this is mahogany, cut out rough. Well, yeah, again, out of order. This is the boom with the sail attached to it, some rope. Yeah, and the finished Optimist Prime. With sail, boom, bridge, everything. Only thing missing here is actually the rudder, which wasn't quite finished at that point. Here it is, the rudder, with some brass fittings on it. Yeah, and this is the tiller. After a few hours of working with the spokeshave and sandpaper, very satisfying to work with mahogany. It gets really, really, really silky smooth. It's so nice. And paint process. I don't know why the order of the photos all of a sudden mixing up, but I don't know how many layers it had here, but maybe 3 or 4 layers. So, this is my daughter Kirsten. And this is the first time we're trying it in the water, so without a mast, because at that point we didn't have the rudder fittings yet, so we couldn't put on the rudder. We just did a small paddle. Here she is, inside the boat. Just a small pond just next to our summer house. I also have a little video that you can see. We're paddling.
Kan du paddle os derhen? Prøv at bruge begge hænder. Flot.
I hope she'll get to like it. The last photo, I think it was the last photo. So I also have a video, and I'll post a link to that, but you can also see it if you want. A video of the boat actually sailing. Here we have it. Oi! Maybe this is stressing the computer a little bit too much, but it works, and it works fine. Lovely boat to sail. I feel a little bit too big for it, but but it works okay. So if you want this in proper video quality, just use the link underneath. So this is filmed using a GoPro, just the cheap basic GoPro camera with a gorilla pod. I'm considering whether to get some flotation bags for the Optimist also. Not in the original specifications, but nowadays if you are sailing Optimist, you should have 3 flotation bags inside it, which will make it easier to, you know, if you should capsize, to get it up again. So that's it. I hope you enjoyed watching the video, and I probably forgot to say a lot of things, and it might have been a little bit confusing because there was no script at all. But if you have any questions, feel free to contact me. Just write a comment and I'll get back to you. Thanks a lot and enjoy. I hope a lot of other people will build Optimist, wooden Optimists in the future, because it's a really fun project. Bye.